What's up, everybody? How's it going? We doing all right tonight? LA. All right. It's good to finally be back open in LA. You know, we opened our office in 2019, the end of 2019. So hell of a time to open an office and pay all that rent for, you know, all that time. But anyways, now that we're back open, we wanted to do it proper and bring in the big dog. So we have our friends from Serato in the building. So make some noise for Sonny James and Serato. We have a couple other members of the Serato team, and you can feel free to meet them, ask them questions and everything a little bit after the workshop ends. They're going to also answer any questions you may have. I want to know real quick, all of you are DJs. Hands up if you're DJs. Awesome. That's all of you. That's great. That's what we like to see. Now, keep those hands up. How many people have been using Serato for more than 10 years? Nice. All right. How many people are newer to Serato? Oh, nice. Welcome to the Serato world, and you have came to the right venue to learn about Serato. So I'm going to stop talking now. My name is Raj. I'm the Director of Operations at BPM Supreme. We have a wonderful staff here today with you. We got Mike Acosta, Bang, Nat, who you met downstairs, Jordan right here making sure I don't go crazy. We got Judd in the house too. So all of the BPM Supreme staff is here to answer questions as well. BPM Supreme, of course, your number one source for music for DJs, and if you don't know, we'll tell you more about that after the workshop. So today, I will let Sonny get on board with the workshop. Welcome to everybody in person and online too. We will be rebroadcasting this online with official Serato people in the chat and BPM people watching along answering the questions. So you might hear us throw to the chat and say, if you have questions, you know, let us know. And we're not live right now, we're pre-recording this, and we'll be live in the chat with people later. So that'll explain that. Thank you very much. Without further ado, make some noise for Sonny. Woo!
And we can't come to BPM Supreme without giving proper applause to my man Raj as well. That's what's up. So first of all, welcome. I appreciate everybody who came out tonight and everybody who's going to be tuned in online. My name is Sonny James, and I am Artist Relations for Serato, based here on the West Coast. Our role is basically an extension of the marketing team, which is based in New Zealand. And we pretty much focus on, you know, marketing everything Serato, from Serato Studio to Sample to Pitch and Time to obviously Serato DJ. And I also develop all the content that comes through the West Coast. So so it's me and my partner Cut Corners over here in the orange hat. And behind this TV, you might see my man Mike Well, who's also from Serato HQ. So we're all here tonight to just provide as much transparency for you guys and as much support as we can, so you guys have the tools that you need to, you know, go out in the wild and get busy. So if you, it's real casual, it's nothing crazy, so if you have questions, feel free to ask us. We're here to help you, and that's it. So so without further ado, let's kind of get started. So I know some of you guys have seen some familiar faces in the crowd, but for those of you who don't know me or are not familiar with me, I've been DJing for, I've been DJing for about 30 years now, and it's crazy to say, it's wild. Anyway, I moved from Philly 5 years ago this month, and I love growing up in Philly because, you know, it's kind of like ground zero for DJing in a lot of ways. Some of the best DJs in the world came from there, so it was just quite a training ground to, you know, grow my legs and basically, you know, learn how to read a crowd, a difficult crowd at that, and basically be able to not sink and, you know, swim with the sharks. So I'm very proud to come from Philly. I love it here in LA, and my role with Serato in here in LA has been a lot of fun. So throughout the years, I've DJed for a bunch of international artists like Mr. Lift, Bahamadia, J-Live, Gennaro Jarrell, Hezekiah, a bunch of like independent rappers, and I've been in a bunch of bands and stuff too. I come from the battling turntablist world, but I also produce as well. We good? And I've done everything. Mixtapes, radio, any kind of event you can think of, I've done it. So hopefully some of the lessons that I learned throughout the years will be of some support to you guys, whether it's on a personal level or just on some Serato shit. So, you know, we're here to do that. So we're here to talk about the CDJ 3000. Anybody here use them yet? One person, two people. No one else has used them? Okay, that's good. So the main thing with the CDJ 3000, obviously it's got a bigger screen. It's also touch screen, but the dopest thing as far as the Serato integration goes is that it's got moving colored waveforms. So that's a first as far as CDJs go. I always wish that we had it in the 2000 series, but you know, it never happened. So here we are with the 2000s, we, I mean 3000s, we've got color waveforms. They've also got new and improved smooth jog wheels. So, you know, you'll notice when you use the CDJ 3000s, they feel a little bit different than the previous series. It's also got enhanced pitch and time functionality, and pardon the audio, we're trying to sort it out over here. And yeah, and it's now an official Serato accessory. It's been out for a few months or so, thanks. And but now it's an official Serato accessory. So we'll get into like the meat and potatoes of how it works as a Serato accessory in a minute. So the first thing that you're gonna wanna know is basically how to get it to work flawlessly with Serato DJ. Who here has used the previous CDJ series? Okay, a bunch of CDJ users. And do you use them more so with control tone, like on a disc or on a USB or HID mode? HID?
USB.
USB, okay, cool. It's a little mix of ways. So my favorite way to use any CDJs is with HID mode because it basically turns your whole setup kind of into a controller. So you get full functionality of pretty much all the functions on the CDJs, including cue points, you know, pitch and time. You're able to see the pitch actually move on the screen as well, and auto loops and beat jump and the rest of it. So it's a really powerful way to use the technology with Serato DJ. So yeah, we'll get into that in a little bit. But the first thing that you need to do is make sure that you're on the latest version of Serato DJ, which is 2.5.7 at this point. Is anybody in this room using the current version? We always ask that because we get a ton of phone calls from people going, this isn't working, this brand new controller is not working. What version are you on? I'm on Scratch Live. So it definitely helps anytime there's new hardware that comes out or there's new support for hardware that's kind of recent in the marketplace to just make sure that you're on. Just make sure you're on a current version of the software because, you know, whenever you see us quietly release a point update is usually to support some hardware that's recently released. So 2.5.7 is the current, and that's what you need to be on in order to get HID working with the 3000s. You also need to make sure that you're on a current version of the firmware. So if we go to Serato, I've got my CDJs plugged in because I'm using HID mode. And for those who don't know, HID is basically, you're bypassing the whole process of using RCAs and control tone. Instead, you're actually going USB direct from each CDJ into your computer. So you might see, you know, if you ever see DJs in the club using HID, you might see a hub. And basically the hub only comes into play so you have more inputs. That's really the only purpose of the hub. And I think a lot of the times when people realize there's like an extra piece involved, they go, oh hell no, I'm not doing that. It's already, I'm good. Like but it's actually less work to do HID when you look at it, because again, there's no RCAs involved and there's no actual control tone. So you go USB direct from the CDJ, from each CDJ, plug both of those into a hub, plug the hub into the computer, and then you plug the mixer direct into the computer. So the reason I say it that way is because sometimes people will plug the mixer into the hub as well, and we don't recommend that you do that. We always recommend that you plug the mixer directly into the computer. Plug the CDJs into the hub, you should be good. So, you know, that's a little nugget for you guys. So if you look at the screen, you can see that Serato has given me a little message that says that I need to update my CDJ 3000s. And immediately when I click on that, it's gonna take me to Pioneer and it's basically gonna give me the download file. I already have it on a USB, so if we can cut to the overhead, I'll show you exactly how to update it. So, good. Okay, boom. So, yeah, so on the CDJs, you've got this USB-A input here, and all you do is just, you put it in there, but the first thing you'd have to do is put the CDJs in firmware update mode. And in order to do that, you hit the NQ loop in button, and you hit the exit loop button. You basically hold those down, and then you turn it on. And you just hold that, and then you can see the key sync button blinking. That's an indicator that is going into firmware update mode. So I'm not sure how clear that is on the screen. Might not be very clear, but it's asking me to connect a USB storage device. So I'm just gonna put my trusty USB. Oh, and before I do that, I should mention that the USB that I have, it has the firmware file on it just by itself. Like, it's nothing else on it. No folder. Yeah, it's just basically the root directory. So you just drop that on there, and you unzip it before you do that. Because I made the mistake of putting the zip on there, not realizing. And I was like, it's not doing anything. So, yeah, just make sure you unzip it, throw it on the USB key, root directory, and you should be good. So I'm going to pop it in. And I'm doing this in real time. These are brand new CDJ-3000s, courtesy of BPM Supreme. And I love this white. I'm ready to steal these joints. Sure, yeah, no problem. Thanks for pointing that out. So it's just saying it's checking the update file. And yeah, it's just waiting, that's all. And right now it's updating from version 1.03 to version 1.21. It says firmware update is complete. Turn the power off before using. And that's pretty much it. So this is something, and it was important that we wanted to show this in real time to you guys so you know not to be afraid of doing it in the club, because a lot of the artists that we deal with are like, I don't know about showing up somewhere and trying to do a firmware update. Suppose it bricks the, you know, CDJ or something crazy happens. But it's extremely rare that something like that happens in my experience. So again, if you have the firmware, and honestly, it helps to maybe have drivers and different firmwares for different pieces of gear that you might connect to just on a thumb drive, just because you never know. You know, you might get somewhere and they say, oh, I know we told you we had a 900 Nexus, but something happened last night. So I'm going to just do the other one now. You probably can't really see it, but same process. Loop in button, exit loop, turn it on. That's if you that's if you show up at least 15 minutes before you play. As long as there's no one playing before you, you know, because even with that, I mean, you can do them one at a time. Like how I would do it, if I needed to update them while someone was DJing, I would just do them one at a time. You know, if someone's using Serato, tell them to rock on internal. You know, if you're updating the firmware on the mixer, that's a different story, because then you have to actually power it off, which is going to kill the party. But if you're doing CDJs, you can still, you know, have the music rocking. I would recommend that. Yeah, for sure. So record box is usually pretty much prioritized with the Pioneer devices like the CDJ stuff. But we also obviously have a great partnership with Pioneer. So most of the devices that are now in the market by Pioneer support Rekordbox and Serato. Originally, yeah. So the official Serato support just launched. Yeah, exactly. So the Serato support just launched like how many weeks ago? A month ago or so is when the Serato support came. And it was a long time coming. You know, we saw all the comments on YouTube and IG like, yeah, this content is cool, but, so, yeah, let me just update this real quick so we can keep it moving. Any other questions? How was parking and whatnot tonight? Because it was, that's good. Well, that could go either way, really, in Hollywood. That's good. Yeah. Well, we got here a little bit earlier during rush hour, and it was a nightmare at first, but we sorted it out. Yeah. For sure. So this one is done updating as well. We're just going to power it off. And then sometimes when we do these things, we need to restart Serato just so it recognizes that there's been a change, but we'll make sure before we do that. There we go. So let's see. Cool. So can we? Yeah, let's zoom in so you can. Cool. And sorry about the light reflection. I know it's not ideal, but we're doing the best we can. Cool. So so this little tab right here just says control mode, CDJ, and there's a little computer next to it. So that means it recognizes that there's a computer connected to it. So when I tap that, all it does is just ask me to select a deck. So it's giving me options 1 through 4. This is my right deck, so I'm going to select deck 2. And it means I'm in there. So this one, same process. I'm going to select deck 1. And load something. So that's pretty much as simple as that. Once you're in there, sorry, let me just get my thing to stop messing up over here. Sorry, I don't know where my slides went. Good old Opera. Sometimes it does that. Cool. If there's any questions or anything, you can feel free to chime in. I've just got to pull my notes back up.
Have you ever had any issues with sound guy objecting to being updated in the firmware? That didn't know you were a
drop. Yes. And the reality is, you know, certain things need to happen in order for the party to continue. And either they want the party to continue or they want to feed their ego. So I just basically just keep it real. So here we go. So again, as I mentioned, the HID setup mode is absolutely the only way that I would use CDJs. I pretty much travel. I'm a turntablist, so I usually pretty much prefer like S11 or, you know, a Rain 72 kind of mixer and turntables. But sometimes that's just not a reality wherever I'm going. So I usually keep in my bag 3 USB cables and a hub just in case I get there and there's CDJs. I want to be comfortable. So the process for HID, like I said, is just very simple. As soon as you plug in, the CDJ should recognize your computer. You select your decks, and you're pretty much in the game. To speak again to the benefits of it, it's a direct USB connection. So you're not dealing with control tone, you're not dealing with RCAs running everywhere, and it's basically a controller at that point. So I'm gonna do my best to kind of show you some of that functionality. But first, we can watch a video from my guy OP. And let me just make sure that I've got proper audio. And this is pretty much a better view of your HID setup situation. So, where are we at?
Virtual decks inside of Serato DJ Pro by HID mode allows you to use the CDJ 3000s to control the virtual decks inside of Serato DJ Pro by USB connection. Make sure to download and install the latest firmware to update each of the CDJs to work in this function. Check the link in the description. For HID mode, you will need a USB hub to connect the 2 CDJ 3000s to your computer. You can also use the built-in USB hub on high-end performance mixers. Connect 1 USB cable from the back of the CDJ 3000 to the USB hub. Repeat this process for the second unit. Connect the USB hub to your computer. On each unit, press the source button. Press the touchscreen and press control mode CDJ. and use the encoder knobs to connect to the virtual decks inside of Serato DJ Pro. As an official Serato accessory, HID mode opens up software control capabilities, utilizing buttons, knobs, and the touchscreen to manipulate hot cues, loops, BPM adjustment and BPM sync and key shift, library browse, song loading, beat jump, and more. If you have any issues, please read the support article below or reach out to the Serato support team.
Yeah, so that's a much saucier version of what I just went through, but yeah, hopefully that, you know, gives you guys a little bit more comfortability in terms of
HID,
in terms of the whole HID process, and yeah, and you won't, you know, be intimidated at all by any of it. So, sorry, let me just make this full screen again. And boom. Okay. Are there any questions about any of the HID stuff? None?
Is there a quick way to check what version the CDJs are with it running? Because, you know, a lot of times you go on and another DJ is playing recording, so you can find out.
That's a great question, actually, and I don't immediately have an answer for that, but let me see if I can get one for you. There's an info button, but it didn't seem to do anything. And if you guys know, feel free to chime in. Oh, so Raj's question was, is there a way to determine what version of firmware the CDJ is on while you're using it?
Yeah, I think it is an info.
Okay, yeah. There, Matt says that there is something in the info button, but I'm not having any success getting it to do anything at the moment. But yeah, when you turn it on, then it should tell you. Same way as a mixer will tell you what version of firmware it's on. So, yeah. No. It's all good. It's all, this is, you know, live and direct, so feel free. Right. Yeah. So the question was, if you leave a hub, if you leave your hub at home, or if your hub fails for some reason, then can you just rock off of two USBs and make it happen in HID mode? And the answer is yes. So my typical solution for that type of scenario is, I will just go direct into the computer from one CDJ, and then I'll just rock off the instant doubles on Serato.
Direct to the CDJ.
To the computer, yep. Yep. Same with the mixer. You go direct. You use both, you know, USB imports. I mean, yeah, and then you're good. You just rock off of, you know, instant doubles.
Because I thought it was just assuming that your laptop doesn't have enough ports.
That's right.
So if it does, you don't need enough.
Then you're Gucci, right, exactly. So. Yeah, so that's a good point, because like my machine, for instance, it has four USB-C inputs. So, yeah, exactly. So if I wanted to just go three USBs in to my computer, then I'm totally fine doing that. I also rock off of an external drive as well, so that also occupies one of my inputs. So, yeah. But the hub is absolutely nothing to be concerned about. It doesn't have to be fancy. It could literally be a $10 hub from Office Depot. We do it all the time. Not in my experience. I mean, you probably want one that's, you know, current. You know what I mean? But yeah. That's right. Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Okay. Info. Boom, there you go. So that's your answer, Raj. So thanks to Cut Corners. On the CDJ 3000, you hold down the menu/utility button, which is the last button over here. You just hold that in, and then it's gonna give you a set of like utility options, and then the last tab on your left-hand side is info. And then it pretty much gives you all your info, including your serial numbers and all that jazz. But the first thing it tells you is what version you're on. And right now we're on the current version of 1.21. So, yeah, that's a great question. Don't do it again. No, I'm just kidding. So, yeah, so does anyone have any more questions about HID stuff? That's a good point. So, yeah, so even though we use the Serato hubs in our content, we don't officially have a licensed hub yet that we can recommend, unfortunately. So, you know, use that. Right on. Yep. Right. Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah, I mean, we're still, you know, Serato HQ is still testing a bunch of hubs to kind of see what, you know, might be the best solution that, that we can provide for CDs, I mean, for DJs. But the, you know, the thing is, it's like, we can't slap our name on something that's not reliable. So that's what's kind of taking long to, you know, make sure that it's up to par. Yeah. So, yeah, so the other thing that we should talk about is ClubKit. Is everyone hip to ClubKit? Like, how many people haven't used it? Okay, so you have, okay, quite a few. So when you're using this kind of setup, which is the 900 Nexus 2 with the CDJs, either 2000s or 3000s, ClubKit is gonna be your best friend. Because basically what's happening is people will show up to clubs and then they see this and they're immediately looking for a Serato box. And we're trying to encourage people to just cut the box out of the equation when you can, go direct into the mixer. The only thing is with that, you do need a DVS license. So a lot of people get confused because when you actually pay for the expansions and you open the program and you see the list of expansions, there's nothing that really says ClubKit. So it's like, where is this thing? So ClubKit, for clarity, is a combination of two licenses. It's the Serato DJ license mixed with the Serato DVS license. So DVS basically allows this mixer to now see your computer and talk to it the same way a box would talk to it. So yeah, so you do need to have the Serato DVS and the Serato DJ license in order to be able to plug direct into a Pioneer mixer like this. So you, where can you find, so, right, so I'm gonna pull up Serato. So if you go up here to your right-hand corner to expansions, this is the list of expansions that are available. So this one right here is the DVS. And as you can see, it says use vinyl, CDJs, and media players in your setup. DVS lets you connect turntables or media players such as CDJs as to supported hardware, giving you the ability to control Serato DJ Pro using control tone, noise map, control tone, vinyl, or CD. So yeah, so once I learned how to use that, it was a game changer for me because boxes can be, you know, nowadays boxes can be pretty unpredictable in terms of availability, reliability. Some of them are old. Sometimes you get to a venue, they've got an SL1 box, and they're like, yeah, we got Serato, go for it. And it just, you know, it's not happening. So you definitely want to have Serato DVS enabled. And I'll go through some of the other expansions here a little bit later. Yep. Right, so you get two activations for every product, for every Serato product. Yeah. Yeah, so let's see here. So let's see here, I'm gonna go to my account. And sorry, it's been a while since I've done it this way. I usually do it on my on the back end. But so we've got my list of devices here, and we can literally just choose which one we want to keep active, and which ones we don't. So I'm an employee, so I've got more licenses here. But nonetheless, you know, this is the screen that you'll go to. You literally just go and click on your profile on Serato.com. And then, manage devices. And then, yeah, it'll literally tell you all of the devices that you have active with the current licenses that you have. And you can, you know, deactivate if you need. That's a good point, actually, because especially now with all the new computers coming out and we're coming out of quarantine and people are upgrading things, you want to be able to make sure that your licenses that you had for, you know, you might have had on a 2012 machine is working on a current machine. Cool. So, yeah, so that's that in terms of club kit and HID. If there's no other questions, I can move on to some of the other expansions. Cool. Okay, so we talked about DBS. Pitching time. Pitching time is kind of like the bread and butter of Serato. Like, it's basically the most powerful time stretching algorithm in the world, basically. And it originally started as a plugin for Pro Tools. And, you know, folks would use it for time stretching in orchestra, for instance. You know, if there's a big studio and they bring in Elton John or whoever and a ton of musicians, and then they realize, like, Elton wants it in a different key, but you just recorded 30 musicians in that key, you can actually use pitching time to flawlessly, you know, change the pitch or change the timing. And most people would, you know, you wouldn't ever even notice. So it's a really popular tool in big studios in Hollywood, and that's Serato's first product that we came out with 20 years ago. And basically pitching time kind of informed the next decision to make Studio Scratch, which turned into Scratch Live, which we now know as Serato DJ Pro. But yeah, that kind of technology sort of started from the pitching time days. And now we're full circle because we have products like Serato DJ Pro and Serato Studio and Serato Sample that have that same kind of technology in there. And it's, you know, it's super powerful to pretty much just be thrown in the mix like that. Let me just give you an example of how pitching time works. So this little guy here, if you don't have pitching time active, I'll show you how that looks. I'm gonna just disable it. And if you guys don't use pitching time, then you might notice that this is a little familiar, this little music note guy. That's just the simple key lock that we fell in love with in Scratch Live back in the day. And now, since Serato DJ is a much more powerful program, we can actually enable pitching time. So let me just give you an example of what pitching time does. I'm gonna change my range here. So that's the normal tempo. Normally at 97, right now it's at 60, and there's no artifact, no indication that I'm time stretching at all. If a person never heard the song, they figure maybe it was made at that tempo. Another cool thing that the pitching time DJ expansion allows you to do is you can actually change the pitch of the song while it's playing. Change the key of the song while it's playing, rather, without changing the tempo. So check it out. So up here, right next to my BPM, I've got a key, which I use the Camelot wheel. So the Camelot key of 3A. And then there's a little music note under it, and I'll show you how that works too. But for now, I can just change it in either direction. So I'm gonna pitch it up a little bit. So So yeah, so you might see content that we film with guys like DJ Trays and like Jay Espinoza and some of those guys, and they heavily use that feature. And also Pitch Play too, which is available on mixes like the S9 and S11, S7. Yeah, it's really dope. Right, so yeah, so if you go to your MIDI mapping, I've got some mapping here from Playlist Retreat, but I don't even remember what it does, so I'm not even gonna play myself. But you can MIDI. It's a good question actually, because this mixer, you can MIDI map a lot of it, and yeah, you can open up some of that functionality. Being able to touch the hardware. Right, so yeah, so you can map that as well. So who was it that mapped? Well, I think it was Jay Espinoza that does that, right? Yeah. So he's just one of the many people that does it, and Miles Medina does it too. But yeah, you can, like, for instance, map the parameter buttons to be your kind of like up and down pitch. Yeah, because at the moment, if you have Serato flip and you're in like hot cue mode, then your left parameter is going to kind of enable the flip to record, and then your right parameter is going to have it play. But yeah, you can map that as well.
So when you're changing the tempo, right, the key state,
yep. Okay, that's a good question. So the question was, what are the artifacts that I was referring to in terms of the time stretch happening with pitch and time? So we'll see if we can hear the difference. Let me disable pitch and time. Yep. Yep. Okay. Cool. So let's put it to the test with a classic. So this is without pitch and time enabled.
It's still bigger than.
Wrong version. Relentless. Fake records. So do you notice it sounds like hella glitchy? Right. So again, the average untrained ear might not notice that much, especially if you're going like maybe a maximum of like 10 BPMs each direction, but DJs are here for sure. Yeah. Yep, so let me just, in the middle of this, let me now enable pitch and time again. Much different.
One thing about music, when it hit, you feel no pain. White folks say it controls your brain. I know better than that. That's game, and we ready for that. Two soldiers headed back. Matter of fact, who got the gun? And where my army at? Rather attack it.
So that's the aerobics mix, if y'all want to use that one. But yeah, I mean, if you're not using pitch and time, it's certainly worth, you know, using, because it just makes everything sound so much cleaner. Yeah, I love it. Okay, so that's pitch and time, DJ. And then who here has heard of Serato Flip? Anyone using it? Just us. Okay, that's dope. All right. Yeah, I'd like to hear how you use it for beats. But yeah, so I don't know. Let me see if I have my little workshop crate here. Show you guys Serato Flip. And we've done this at BPM Supreme before and had a great time talking about Flip. But Serato Flip, in a nutshell, is basically automation. And what that means is if you're tapping cue points, or if you're hitting the reverse, that like temporary, you know, reverse sensor button, it'll actually kind of record that in the metadata of the track, which means it'll be there, and if you share that track with other people, not that we're encouraging people to share music, but if you do share music with people, then that metadata will go with it the same way your cue points and your loops and whatnot does.
Shout out BPM Supreme, if you can download free flip tracks.
Yeah, so yeah, that's actually right. So Cut Corners made a good point. We you know, we've had a partnership with BPM Supreme for years now, and one of the dope initiatives that we did was we actually trained the folks at BPM Supreme a few years back to make Serato flips, like, for their pool, so that you can actually go to, you know, BPM Supreme site and you can actually download pre-made flips already. And the benefit of that is that you can actually have multiple versions of a song on the same MP3. So, you know, most of us, if we're downloading from pools, we got quick hitter versions, we got a clean version, we got a dirty version, we got an intro version, we got a version that cuts just to Drake. It becomes like overkill on the drive, but you can literally do all of those versions on the same MP3. I wish I could tell you how it worked. I didn't make it, but big up to the guys who did. I'm going to show you. So am I up on this? Here we go. You can take the CDJs out, if you don't mind. Boom. Here's a good example. So this is one of my favorite flips made by the homie Cut Corners. And you know, the classic Kendrick Lamar King Kunta record. It does not start with any intro. It literally just gets to the point.
I got a bone to pick. I don't want you.
Okay, so that was going into the flip. So, okay, so if you can see this, this little side panel here next to your cue points, the first one is your hot cues. The third one are your pre-saved loops. And this one in the middle that often gets overlooked is your flips. So here, to answer your question about how do you access the different flips, it's going to be in this window here. So if I've got the flip off, then it's just going to play the song.
I don't want you monkey mouth motherfucker sitting in my throne again.
And then we've made an intro version. So basically what Matt did was he basically took the open parts of the song where there's no vocals, and he just set cue points there in order for it to play like an intro. So it does that for 8 bars, and then Kendrick comes in. So let's just turn this one on, and then we're just gonna play it. You see it jumping in real time. Yep, so yeah, really, really dope. I use that one all the time when I'm in the club. And we've also made an instrumental version of that as well. So it's basically, it's essentially the same flip. It's just no Kendrick. So let me give you an example of that.
But a rapper with a ghost rider.
My bad. I didn't play the right one. Idea is, thank you. And the reason I do that is just to show you that no matter how much I manipulate it, the flip stays, it's there, it's locked. So yeah, so even if you've got to do whatever, if you got to cut over it or bring it back or whatever, you're not going to come out of the flip unless you want to. And it's relatively easy to set up, and I'll show you how. I'll show you pretty much. Oh, you know what, let me show you another example too. So Flip is another expansion, and all these expansions are part of the Serato DJ suite. So we always recommend just get the suite, because you never know, you know, like when a tool like that might come in handy. And everything's included in the suite. So here's a, say what? Yes. Yeah, so the subscription for Serato DJ suite is $9.99 a month, and And it's, that's what I thought. $299 just outright. Yeah. Sure. A difference in terms of what? Nope. No, it's the same. Yeah, it's the same thing. So the question was, for those who are checking in online and whatnot, is there a difference, I guess, in functionality between the subscription and buying it outright? And the answer is no. It's the same deal. Yeah. So here's another example of a Serato flip. This is one I like to Oh, yeah, my bad. Yep. So, right. So, again, this is, you know, the Nexus 900, the 900 Nexus 2 isn't, like, natively made for Serato, so it's not immediately mapped, but you can MIDI map it. Yeah, yeah, no problem. So, yeah, so another way that you can use Serato Flip is to kind of get to the point versions, right? So we've got... The choice is yours. We all know it. You know what? Let me just do this one. Let's turn this one on instead.
Engine number 9 on the New York Transit.
What I call getting to the point.
If my train goes off the track, pick it up, I get up, I get up, I get back on the scene.
So again, you might notice that the reverse is actually there in the metadata.
Won't play rock, won't play the pebble. Open the door, you better believe we're sliding through it swiftly. Niftily, we can make it hip to be. What we are, cause what we be. Be the epitome, do is die, dip it in. So now I dwell just to say you're plain. Pull your cup, cause I got the container. Pass the plate up, cross the fader. You can play like the Sony innovator. Never the traitor. Party of flavor. And you can get a scoop. Now you can get with this or you can get with that.
So I like to do, sometimes I'll play that version just to mess with the crowd. You know? Because everyone's going to be saying that later. Oh, shit. So, yeah, I like to do that sometimes when I'm playing. I'll show you one more example and then I'll show you how to make one. This is another one courtesy of the homie Cut Corners. You know what? I'm going to go with this one. I like this one. So this is the Miss Fat Booty joint. Oh, range, my bad.
I'm only one step the head of heartbreak. I know I can't afford to stop.
That's pretty much the flip. And the dopest part about using Serato flip for me is that I can do that live. So, you know, depending on the scenario, you know, people might want to see you do it live. And if that's the case, you turn off the flip, you do the shit live, get your round of applause, keep it moving. but if you're playing at a retail store, nobody gives a shit. You know what I mean? It's like, so, you know, we all know as DJs, there's gigs that we take for passion, there's gigs that we take for money, and these tools allow you to be prepared in either scenario, is how I see it. Boom. Okay. Yeah. It's a great tool for production ideas. Do you just record those ideas from Flip into a DAW, or do you literally just make the beat, like, on Flip? That's fire. That's fire. Yeah. That's dope. Yeah. It's, have you used Serato Studio yet? Serato Studios, I think it's this tool that we're talking about is dope, but it's basically Serato Studio is this concept on steroids. Like, yeah. 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 That's right. Yeah, the power of studio for me is that it's just quick, you know, and that's why I love working for Serato, because we're solving the right problems, if you ask me, you know, because I started out making beats on the MPC 2000 XL years ago, and even still now, even though that was like 15, 20 years ago, I still don't really know what I was doing on the XL. So using Serato Studio, especially since my brain is already thinking like Serato DJ, you know, so when I open Studio, it just, I'm pretty much brought right back into the same mode of thinking that I am using Serato DJ. So you definitely might get it, enjoy it, you know. It's a dope workflow. So real quick, let me just show you an example of how to make a quick flip. Studio is actually a separate product. Yeah. Yep. So we all know the honey drippers. So we've got our cue, my cue points already set. And this is another thing that you want to do if you're making a flip, is you kind of want to have an idea of what you're going to do with the cue points before you actually try to record your flip. So let me open this panel up here at the top. That's my Serato flip panel. And then I'm just going to hit this little record here. And it's basically, sorry, let me just take that off. It's basically waiting for me to feed it info when I turn it on. So let me just come out of that. So the minute I hit the first cue point, it's actually recording the information to the metadata of the track. So I got it playing now, and I'm just gonna enable it. Let me do it again. So that's my flip. Say that I'm happy with that. I'm just going to click save here. And then it's literally just going to save it here to the empty slot. And I'm just going to call this one BPM demo. And that's it. It shows up in parentheses on my track, so you know which version it is that you're playing. So for instance, if I had that one playing and I wanted to access a different one, I'll just engage it. Yeah. Say that again? Yeah. So yeah, does it max out at six versions, or you can six version total, right? So yeah, so there's six actual flips that you can make per file. And yeah, and it all saves there. And again, you can either do that, you can rearrange a track, you can make a clean version. There's times when I made, you know, there's songs that are like popular versions, and I'm like, damn, I don't have a clean, so I can just make one on the way to a gig or whatever, and you can literally just record it in there. And it doesn't matter whether you're plugged into hardware or not. If you have the flip expansion, you can make one. Yep.
So it saves it in the metadata, right? So
yep.
Is there
a way to say, like, you love that version of that track you created, you can export that, and you have to use it in Serato and access that? That's a great question. So the question was, if you make the flip, can you export that, or do you have to play it in Serato? And the answer is you have to play it in Serato. Yeah, it's literally a tool for using in Serato DJ.
The reason is because, like, I love Serato, of course, but, like, I'm not, like, you
Fair enough. We all are. That all happens to all of us. Yeah, for sure. But I mean, in that case, if you have flips that you know you want to access later, then you could always just record it in the program. Yeah. Yeah. What's up, Ghost? Absolutely. So Ghost's question is, can you quantize when you're making a flip? And the answer is yes. Yeah. And in fact, we recommend it when you're doing intro edits and things that you kind of need to be on a grid so that you can mix properly. I would always use quantize for something like that. Oh, so yeah. So quantize, and this gets overlooked a lot, but quantize is literally the little cue guy, the little cue up here. And yeah. Can you see it? It might be a little bit small, but it's at the very top of the screen. There's length, MIDI, and quantize. Yeah. For sure. Oh, yeah. So quantize basically is a snap-to-grid function. So, you know, basically it somewhat corrects your timing in order to get it to fall directly on the one. So so quantize is more so when you're actually hitting the cue point, it's actually snapping your timing. But sync is actually like matching your BPMs. Yeah. Yeah. So where are they at? So for me, I mean, because I've been using flip for a minute, I would probably just use it without quantize. I recognize that my timing won't always be perfect, but I'll always just record it again if I feel like I need better timing. But definitely if it's an intro edit or outro edit, something that I'm going to need to be mixing another record with, then I would use quantize. But if I'm just drumming, just fucking around, then yeah, I'm just going to just go for it. Yeah, what's up? That's a great question. So the question was, does it record the effects as well when you're doing the flip? And no, the only two things it's recording are your cue point movements and your sensor, like slash reverse. Yeah. So yeah, it's a tool that's been in there for a minute, and I think a lot of people look at it and they go, ah, I'm good, and they just kind of skip over it. But it can actually be useful in a number of scenarios. So yeah, what's up, Ghost? Say that again? No, I don't think so. No, Ghost was asking, is there a limit in terms of how long the flip can be? And no.
Nope.
Yeah, if there is, yeah. Cut corners with sand, and we haven't found it if there is one. So yeah. Sure. That's a great question. So if you go into your settings here, which I pulled up, you can see on the screen, on the DJ Preferences tab, at the bottom of the first little panel here, it's showing you the quantize value. So you can change your quantize value here from 1/16th all the way up to 4 beats. And for me, I generally keep it somewhere between a half a beat and a beat. That's just my personal preference, but it might take some troubleshooting for you guys to decide what's best for you. But that's where you find it in the DJ Preferences tab. Yeah. These are all great questions, by the way. Yeah.
So you mentioned that like BPM Supreme, right? Like they have a lot of flips. Is there a different tab wherever to find those specifically, or do you have to like hold the track that looking for has flips?
I think so.
Yeah, so Raj is actually from BPM Supreme, so he can probably answer that question.
Oh, right.
So if you guys are on the site and you see Serato logo, you see the flip logo next to the song. And that means that it's got a flip version to where you download it. And you can see it play around with our versions for inspiration for your own. There's plenty of free slots left that you have, if not three, that our staff makes for you guys to test, handcraft, for you guys for the flip. So we also have the beat grid as well. So look for the Serato logos on our site. When you download them, there's a reason they have there's a rolling logo for deep gridded stuff when they're perfect.
perfectly on time. And they're probably used to agree with stuff in a second, but yeah, that's what that's doing.
Word. So, yeah, so for the people who are tuned in and maybe they didn't hear that, Raj was just saying that there's a Flip logo next to the tracks that have Flip enabled on the BPM Supreme pool. So definitely check for those. And yeah, so moving on to Serato Video. So anyone use Serato Video? Yeah, yeah, Ghost. What's up? Yep. Oh, you mean like on the hardware? So, yeah, so on the CDJs, there's actually a reverse button on the CDJs when you're using HID mode. There's no sensor, not on the S9. Nope. Yeah. But you could map one, obviously, but natively, no. Yeah. So, yeah. Sorry. So, Serato Video? Anyone use Serato Video? My man? That's what's up. That's what's up. We love to hear it. That's lit. Yeah, so cool. So Serato Video is a tool that I've been using for at least 10 years. And in the context that I would use it is I would basically make or have made instrumental versions of like artist videos. So then when I'm DJing for a rapper or something, we actually have them rapping the song while the video is actually playing. And that's always like just like an icing on the cake experience for people at the show. Like, oh damn! And there's a whole bunch of you know, artists who use it, like DJ, like Cut Chemist from Jurassic 5, Jaden Smith's DJ Crespo uses it. Sugar Shay was on tour using it with Bad Baby, and there's a bunch of artists who use Serato Video in a bunch of different ways. But I'll show you guys how I use it. It's definitely become a tool that's been used more frequently in my circle just because of the pandemic. Everyone's been live streaming. So I don't know, let's pick something good. This is just like my video crate. And I've got a partition drive, a 2 terabyte partition drive. One is just audio and one is just video. And the reason I do that is because I might not always need the video. So if I'm at a gig and I don't want my library to have to read a whole bunch of unnecessary files, I'll just eject that partition and just rock my audio. So, I don't know, let's find some heat.
By the way, if you watch Twitch, Sonny James Twitch channel's fire, this crazy video said do the whole Jamiroquai tribute.
Oh, word. Thank you, man. Yeah, it's been fun DJing on Twitch, at least using this particular tool, because, you know, a big part of Twitch is eye candy, right? It's like it's a community for gamers primarily. So, you know, if you're gonna be DJing, you probably wanna be engaging with the audience and you wanna be providing something that's like multimedia kind of for people so that they kind of, you know, they stay locked in. So. It pisses me off. Yeah. Yeah, no, the question was, is how do we feel about Twitch muting the sets when we're done, and it pisses me off. I put a lot of effort into preparing for sets, and I put a lot of love and time into actually performing them. So definitely when I go back and I see like 30 minutes out of like 2 hours is gone, I'm just like, yeah, I've tried Mixcloud. I just realized that my audience isn't fully there yet.
Right.
So exactly. So I mean, it's definitely a dope platform, and you know, we've done Serato Cast and things like that on Mixcloud, and I have my own live mixes on there and whatnot. But in terms of the live experience, it's just you can't really top the audience being where they are, you know. And I mean, the good thing about Twitch is that they're not like flagging your mix while you're performing and pulling you off the air, kind of how they do on Instagram and other platforms. So I love it for that factor. At least I'm like comfortable knowing that if you're here, you're catching this shit now. But I can't tell you five minutes after I hit stop streaming what's gonna happen. But yeah, and it's weird because some of the stuff that they flag is like random. You know, I'll be like, wait, that James Brown record did it? Like, you care about that record? I care about it, but you care about it? I don't know. So, Yeah, it's just weird. It's just weird, but nonetheless, this is where we're at with the copyright cops. So this expansion is up here next to Flip. I'm just going to close Flip, and I'm going to open Serato Video. So now you can see it's kind of taking over my screen, but typically it would go, I would pull this off of my screen onto an external display so I could still see my Serato screen. So we'll just pretend that this is an external display, and I'm just going to make it full screen. So we all love Little Sims. And it's pretty much just like playing an MP3, instead I'm playing MP4.
Niger women got the melanin dripping. Nella Wendy, O-N, city girl living. Looking like chili pepper. You know, tougher than imperial. He was getting bitter while she was getting better. Diamonds are forever. Sierra Leone looking like a gem. Looks hard in the week. Hard on the weekend. You know you wanna live. No, you wanna live with no one watching how you spend. But a thing for the finems and the finems. Miss Tanzania, she would die. Says she wanna know about the support. He hit the zoo. One, got an ocean full of knowledge. You could scuba dive. Miss Ethiopia can play so.
Yeah. Thank you. I could listen to that song forever, by the way. That record is insane. If you haven't heard her album, definitely check it out. It's dope. Nonetheless,
can you repeat that?
That was Lil Sims. Yeah, S-I-M-Z. She's got a couple of records, but her last record is outrageous. So anyway, you'll notice if you have Serato Video enabled that these screens now open, and it's kind of giving you like a visual cue. So on my left deck, I don't have anything playing, and you can kind of see what's going on here. And then in my right deck, it's actually still playing, so you can kind of see it visually changing as I fade from one image to the other.
So can you just throw your crossfader in the middle and have a second
crossfader? Sure. Yeah. So you can, if you want to, you can leave your crossfader in the middle and you can have each playing, and there's a bunch of visual effects that you can apply. You can really go down a rabbit hole with this. There's some, certain things that I do. I do a show on my Twitch channel called Instant Classic. So what I'll do is, let me just set it up for you in real time so you can see. So these two little boxes here next to the crossfader button is you can upload an image here. So sometimes I'll upload my logo, or I'll just type in text here. So let's type in some text. And then now it's going to ask me what kind of font I want to choose. And I'm going to choose my trusty old Jamiroquai font. And let's make it, 18 point. Let's see how that looks. And then let me turn it on. What am I missing here? Oh, that's what it is. Boom. So that's my little Instant Classic logo. It's pretty static and boring, but I can change it here. Let me bring this down. So now, when my track is playing,
getting it on our own, nigga.
Self-made,
ain't nobody doing gold, nigga. Now, Miss India always speaks with her chest.
I can make it over the top.
From her people, because she leaves them the best.
And I can turn it turn down my old passing
queen in the flesh, know the crown get heavy, still the bees in your head.
So we can see when that's ladies, know you hustle on the day. That is a little bit big, so I'm just gonna shrink it. Summer in the 80s. Your time is seeing you blow now. Yeah, let's try to
intelligence and elegance, cool. Show them how. Miss Jamaica understand food for the soul. She get up in the kitchen or she throw down. Ain't nothing without a woman, no. Woman to woman, I just wanna see you glow. Tell them what's up.
And I can even fade it out. I can just fade the opacity out, which I'll do sometimes. Nice little effect there. Yeah. Another thing that you can do is you can upload your logo. So I'll throw a PNG of mine in there. And hopefully I can find, there we go. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah. So, so the comment was that this looks like a tool that producers could also use. So, absolutely. So, what I would do if I wanted to kind of create a visual for YouTube is I would just maybe play my beat in Serato DJ, and then enable video, and then I would use my media crate, which I'll show you in a second, to provide a visual for it, and you can throw your logo over that. So I'll show you that in a second.
So it wouldn't have to be a MP4 file,
which I wouldn't track itself. Correct. So if you don't have an MP4 of a track and you want to play it, which you know happens a lot, I play a mixture of MP3s and MP4s, then there's a crate that opens up called the media crate. And basically that allows you to throw any kind of pieces of like content in there. It could be, you know, weird interviews of Bob Marley or whatever. You know, it could be, you know, riot footage or whatever fits your style. You can literally throw those clips in there. And then while you're playing MP3s, Serato will sort of randomize and pick different visuals to go with the MP3s. And I got to tell you, I don't know how it does it, but it seems like it picks like the appropriate pieces of content for me. I'm sure it's totally by accident, but it looks like I intentionally did it. I look way smarter than I am online. Absolutely, yeah. And you can totally manipulate that in the same way, and I'll show you that in a second. But where's my logo at? Did I put it in here? Okay, so. Yeah, I hear you. So, yeah, so here's my logo, and same kind of deal. Let me just load a new song here. Same deal, not much going on. I'm just gonna have this one scroll. And sometimes I'll do this if I'm playing somewhere with screens and I just want people to remember who's playing, but pay attention to me. Yeah. So, you know, another dope way to use it. Let me just show you guys the media crate. So this is my media crate. It's got a bunch of files in it that I've just downloaded off the internet or got from various sources. There are some free pieces of content that you can get from Serato.com as well. You know, free giveaway stuff. There's like free sounds, and there's also free visuals for streaming as well. So if anybody's like thinking about streaming, but it's like, I need to get a designer to hook my overlay up and all that, you can actually download all those things from Serato.com for free. Our creative team literally did that just so the DJs could have what they need to keep working during this madness.
Put that in the chat.
So, yeah, exactly. So we'll make sure we have that information in the chat for you guys. No doubt. Yeah, we appreciate you guys as well. So, so these are some random pieces of media that are in here, and like here's an example of one. There's no audio attached to it, but it's just a little nice little graphic that if I'm using green screen, I can stand in front of it, and it's, you know, it's pretty engaging, but it's not so engaging that people aren't paying attention to you, you know. Right. So the question is, what quality are the videos? We recommend 720. Yeah. I mean, you could do 1080 as well, but I found that 720 seems to be the best, and it's still pretty clear, you know, when you're outputting to a larger display, and on Twitch, you don't really need it that much bigger than 720.
I think one of the most important things is you need to have a graphics card that can handle that, too.
Yeah, that's right. So to cut Connor's point, you definitely want to have a decent graphics card on your computer so it can handle the the amount of resource that it's using. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I mean, the better the specs, the better for laptops. I mean, you know, we frequently get calls about, should I get this M1 computer? Should I get this Big Sur computer? Should I upgrade? Should I do? And yeah, I mean, as a rule, we tell you to kind of hold off when the OS drops immediately, because it kind of takes our development team to some time to make sure that everything's like tight. We don't want to just put something out there and it's just like crashing on you in the club. So yeah. So definitely wait when it's a brand new OS. But at this point, we're pretty good with the with Monterey at this point. M1 is supported. M1 is supported, but I should note that if you use older pieces of hardware, like some of the older like SL boxes and things like that, a lot of it won't be compatible. Like none of the boxes are compatible with like the current OS in the M1 machine. So it's unfortunate and it's a bummer, especially people who, you know, have 62s at home and things like that, but that's the nature of technology, right? Kind of moves on. Yeah, so let me just play a track for you real quick, and then I'll just give you an idea of how the media crate is picking things. So I don't know, we've got some J-Rock stuff in here. So again, this is just pulling a random thing from my media library. So if I throw this over. See, I'm manipulating it the same way as in any other MP4. So you should notice. So you'll notice that there is no video for this, and that's because I associated an old video with this that's no longer on my drive. So let me just turn that off, and then I'll load it again. And now it's actually pulling a visual in. So the associate function is a really important one, because sometimes if I'm playing a track, this is a good example of this actually, because I will probably do doubles of this track. I'll probably do a little bit of juggling and cutting back and forth. And I don't want my visual changing on each side. So if I load this track again on my right, as you can see, it's loading a different visual. So if I'm over here, it's dope.
Yeah.
When I come over here, different visual.
Yeah. Yeah.
So then what I'll do is, and I do this in real time all the time, is if I find a visual that I think really works for the song, I'll just click associate, and therefore every time I load this track now, it's going to associate this media file as long as this file is on my drive that I'm using. So if I load this again on my right, now it's exactly the same on both sides. So. Associated, so therefore it's always going to be the same. But yeah, you get the idea. It's a really powerful tool, and you can use it in, you know, a number of ways. And I can't emphasize this enough, like doing live streams, it always helps to have just another tool in your arsenal to just, you know, make it a little bit more interesting for people who are tuned in. Because, you know, you might have the fire set, but if you have that other little element that's just going to keep them, you know, engaged on another level, it always helps. Oh, yeah, my bad. Question?
Do you want to scratch the song, but not the visual? Can you disconnect them, or?
Yes. Wait, can you scratch? So, in other words, you're saying you want to scratch the audio, but keep the video just moving. No, it's going to move. Yeah, it's going to move with the. That's what I was gonna say. You can turn the crossfader off and the up and down faders off, but the actual vinyl movement is always gonna still manipulate the timing of the track. Yeah, but yeah, you can turn off the crossfader right here. It's the XF link. Turn off crossfader link, and then anything I do here is not. Sorry, it's probably better if I. Anything I do here is not gonna change. So right now you're just seeing the visual from my left deck, but not my right deck. Yeah. Yeah, you can't use Serato video with four decks. Yeah. That would be dope. Yeah. No, that's a great point, actually. Yeah. Yeah, another question. Sure. That's a great question. So the way I use it, I stream with two different computers. So I DJ off of one. So that's why I don't really have any like reservations about using all the extra expansions and stuff, because I'm literally just DJing off of my computer. And then the computer I'm streaming off of is a gaming PC. So in order for me to get the signal, the video signal feeding from my DJ computer to the PC, I've got to use a game capture card or a switcher like Cut Corners is using right now. And and that basically kind of converts the video signal so that the PC can see it. Yeah, that's the best way to do it. And you know, there's a number of game capture cards. Some of them are kind of whack and some of them more expensive, but honestly, the Elgato is probably the one I probably use the most. Same, yeah. Right. Right, so so Cut Corners is an answer.
There is a client called Siphon that allows you to type the output into Audius.
Okay.
If you're using the same computer, it's possible.
Yeah.
It's just called Siphon. I don't really know how to use it, but I don't know how you do it.
Yeah. So Siphon is a good solution if you're using one computer. But so you can look that up. But these are all great questions. Anything else? Ghost. Yeah. Yep. Great question. So Ghost's question is, if he has a song that's an MP3 and an MP4, and this is a common thing for me. Like sometimes I might get a video from, I don't know, the randomest of sources, and the video is super clean, but the audio is shit. So sometimes what I'll do is I'll just reference the 320 MP3 that sounds clean and crispy, and then I'll just grab the video and then I'll associate it to the track the same way I just did my my media folder. Yeah, and it's usually pretty, you know, timed pretty well, unless the video's got like a bunch of nonsense in the beginning, like, yeah. I'm coming over to your girl. No, it was dumb shit. Sorry, what'd you say? I don't. If I realize when I'm playing that it's a little bit off, then sometimes I'll just cut back to me and then kind of cut back to it just so people can see it. But that's because I'm like not willing to do the extra work of going in Final Cut and, you know, it's like kind of DJing for free, so on Twitch, so I'm not trying to go bananas with the pre-prep, but you absolutely can if you want. Yeah. Cool. Yeah, so so the question about producers using this tool. So real quick, I'm just gonna show you the record option. So, and as you can see, it's actually recording the signal directly from the mixer, so you hear my mic as well. You're seeing that in the mix. And then you can actually pull this down. You can pull this mix menu down, and it'll ask you what channel it is that you're trying to record. So if there's a track that you just made and you want to attach it to like another piece of media, then you can just go ahead and record video mix. And then, I don't know, let's see. I'm going to pick something that I know doesn't have a video attached to it. Look at all this cut corners nonsense. Oh, that's a video. Oh, you know what? I like... So yeah, so there's no video for this. And it's just randomly attaching a piece of media that's on my drive.
Yo, what's up?
So I can literally just record this video mix, and it's just gonna output this. Love the kiss, yo, love the click, 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 love the drive to the family, had to lose my sanity. Gave it up for rap music, gold in the vanity. Had to lose my privacy, sold it for a dynasty. Need the baby rich, I could get my mind to find. Yeah, so that's kind of your, you know, shortcut solution for, you know, just outputting a quick video to something that you might have just made. You can just attach it to another piece of media, put your logo on it, or, you know, whatever kind of treatment you think is going to be fresh, and then record it, and that's it. Yeah. Cut Corners produced that, by the way. It's a hard joint. Yeah, so that's pretty much Serato Video in a nutshell. So the last thing I want to talk about in terms of expansions is Serato Play. Serato Play is a really powerful tool that was actually our last expansion that we added to the pack. And basically what it does is it opens up your program to be able to have the same functionality that you would have if you were plugged in, even when you're not. So in other words, you know, when you plug into a mixer, your decks show up like this, and you've got access to your sampler, and where is it? Do I even have my samples here? Oh, I do.
And it's he's the baby.
Sorry. Sampler is here. And it's coming through master.
Mr. Sonny James.
There we go.
James.
So these are my samples. I can record. I can use my effects. I've got an EQ and filter. All those things are normal when you're plugged into hardware, but when you're not, oftentimes they all disappear. With Serato Play, they all come back. So you can pretty much do a mix in the program without hardware attached, and it's like pretty much like you're mixing on hardware. So that's it. That's an expansion that's $29.99, I believe. And again, it's a great tool for prepping a set, for doing a mix on the fly. Oh shit, I got a deadline, I didn't know, and I got a flight. I can do the mix in the air. And I've done that plenty of times using Serato Play. Yeah, yeah. So it's a little difficult for me to unplug and show it to you now because of just the way the Touch Bar computer is set up. It's gonna bug out when I unplug from this unless I restart. So yeah, Serato Play, definitely a dope tool. I suggest checking it out. And they weren't there. Yeah, so the question was, how do you make sure your samples are saved? That's a great question. So what I do is I usually store my samples on my internal drive, even though I DJ off of my external drive. And what I do is I make a crate of just my samples, and my shit's a mess now, but Here it is. So SP8, this is my A bank right here, and this just has all my samples in it that just stay in that crate. And then when I'm ready, you know, when I was ready to set up my banks, I pretty much put them where I want. And as long as that crate's there, then the samples will be there too. So yeah, you know, this is my.
Jesus Christ!
Yeah. Oh, that's good. Yeah. I like to use a bunch of wild shit when I'm DJing. Yeah. But all that stuff's in there. Like, yeah. Here we go.
Broco.
Yeah. There's a number of things in there.
Five.
Yeah. Yeah. That's saved in the sample bank, and it's also saved in the crates. So yeah, so I know they're there. And if for some reason something disappears, sometimes technology does weird things, but in the event that that happens, I can always go back to that crate and quickly drag it back in. I'm not like spotlight searching, where is that Jesus Christ? You know, yeah.
Honestly, I've had a lot of trouble with external hard drive utility samples like that too.
Really?
Yeah, I always go internal.
Yeah, for samples, I tend to just go internal, just because sometimes I might be doing demos for people without my drive attached, and I want to be able to,
I don't know what it is, but sometimes it's just like, it's grayed out, and I'll unplug it and plug it, and then
right.
All of a sudden it'll be there.
Okay.
Sometimes it
won't. Yeah. Well, so, yeah, sometimes there could be some kind of conflict with permissions on the drive. We've seen that a few times. Yeah. But yeah. Roger's mentioning beat gridding. So I'll just quick, I know we're kind of like getting close to 9, so I want to get to the point, but.
I've never seen
them. And this is nothing. Like I have partners in my DJ crew that got twice this easily. Yeah. Yeah. And a lot of these I have collapsed because, you know, I might not always need to go reference a big artist database, or I might not need access to my videos or all of this like random hip hop stuff or whatever. But yeah.
Is that the
Yeah, that's just my method. I mean, this is just my method of, since Scratch Live days, just kind of building it based on kind of general categories. Like, there's a couple different ways I do it. So I kind of categorize my crates based on like genres. And then I also do smart crates as well, which I can show you real quick. But yeah, generally I try to keep things tagged in a way that I can easily access it just like on the fly. So sometimes I'll be like, oh, okay, this track, oh shit, that track might work with this, and then I can easily type in certain keywords that are specific to me, but nobody else would even know what it means. So like for instance, here's my collection of smart crates. So me and my DJ crew, we used to do a party in Philly, New York, and San Francisco called Body Rock. And basically, it was just kind of all like, it's a mixture of like true school and like, you know, feel good, hip hop, funk, soul, dance classics, and things that are like, to me, like music that I actually care about versus music that I have to play for money. So what I do is I have kind of a number system, and I'm kind of giving away the sauce now, but my number system is like, it's like 1, 2, 3. So you see I have BR1, BR2, BR3. So BR1 is like music that people who came to our party 15 plus years ago would have been into then, and they probably would respond to now. So it tends to be skewing towards the older 35 and up crowd. So you know, there's records by LL Cool J in there, there's records by J Dilla in there, there's records by Beanie Man and New Birth and James Brown. And then Body Rock 2 is kind of like my more youthful crate. So there's Drake songs, Meek Mill songs, Roddy Ricch songs, Tierra Whack. So it's just kind of like shit that I like, but it's more like contemporary. And then Body Rock 3 is kind of like openers and closers. So these are things that like are still bops, but they're just kind of like more mellow, maybe. Like stuff for when people are sitting at the bar, or things when I'm like trying to be like, all right, I'm wrapping it up. You know, if it's a night that I feel like is like ran its course, and I'm like, it's the wrap it up B crate. Yep, so yeah, so then I got, you know, shit like, you know, Al B. Shore remixes and Roy Ayers and stuff like that. Like, all right, bro, like, all right, bro, like, yeah, like, you turned up enough, it's time. So, yeah, so anyway, that's kind of like my method for smart crates, and I'll show you quickly how to make one. So right here next to your regular crate, add crate option, you've got to add a smart crate option. It's another thing that, you know, often gets overlooked, but it's a really useful tool. So the dope thing about smart crates is that you can add your own rules. So you can basically make smart crates based on your needs. So for instance, one time I was doing a radio show somewhere overseas, and I was trying to think of, like, all right, what's going to be my angle? And then I was like, oh, Rod Temperton had just passed not too long before that, and I was like, I'm going to just do all Rod Temperton. But I'm like, how the hell do I, like, quickly find all Rod Temperton songs? So what I would do is I'd add a rule, and then you can pull down this column here, and then you can add composer contains, and then you can literally add whatever whatever composer you think it is. So I don't know what I've got in this machine, but let's just say Rod Temperton. And then I'll add the crate. And let's see if anything comes up. Still thinking. And there we go. These are all songs that Rod Temperton either is the composer or he has a credit on. Sure. So the question is, where does that metadata come from? And the answer is, it's a mix of both. It's some info that I put in, because some of it is like records that were recorded. So obviously that's not going to have metadata in it if it came from an analog source. But I'll go in and I'll physically type it in. And then music that you get from places like iTunes will have a bunch of that metadata in there. So if, for instance, if you want to do like the Ill Timbo set, it might be in there if you've got a bunch of your tracks from legit sources. I believe it does, but I don't 100% know. You don't think it does? Okay. Well, yeah, the jury's out on that one, but my bad.
There was like another Serato video that was like, I watched on YouTube, but like got me in the habit of like every time I do like a big upload, go in and do that shit work of like filming all that stuff.
Yeah.
After smart creation.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, honestly, if you're treating DJing like a job and you take a few hours or even just a couple hours, like every few days, and just do some of this cleaning up, it goes a long way. Like, I mean, I decided, I don't know how long ago, maybe you remember, Cuddy, but it was maybe 3 years ago. I was like, I'm getting rid of my whole library. I was doing these traveling gigs, and even though I was in different cities and playing the same set, I was like, I felt like I was kind of getting away with murder. And it was weird because, like, I could totally do it. I could totally play the same set tonight here that I played last night in a different city. And it's cool. But in my mind, I'm like, this is kind of not challenging enough. So I felt like I was, like, playing the same sets over and over, and it was getting whack. So in order to make it more interesting for myself, I was like, I'm wiping everything. And it was, yeah, that's how it felt when it was gone. I was like, God damn it. But once I did it, I was like, it basically forced me to create a new method for rocking a party. Because I could, like I said, I've been doing it almost 30 years. So I literally know what worked 10 years ago in the right room could work today. But I need better for myself. I need to be driving home like, all right, that was a good night. You know what I mean? Not like I phoned it in. Yeah.
Okay, so I am kind of like
picking
up the same thing.
Yeah.
Like all my crates, I kind of crates right
now. Yeah.
And then I'm like, I usually like I kind of play the same stuff. Yeah. Like, should I just save everything or just put drive or something and then go back to
the same? I mean, honestly, it's to each his own. I know for me, it was like years and years of the same, me relying on the same crate structure, the same sub crates, the same. You know, I know this Baltimore club song is going to go with this Baltimore club song that's going to take me to a house tempo that's going to, it's like, it was so monotonous that I felt like I could do it with my eyes closed. But, 1 second. But for me, it was like, I know that if I start relying more on smart crates, and less upon like the crates that I've built over the years, that I'm always kind of freestyling. So even now, we're doing a workshop, and I don't have a crate that's like for this workshop. I'm just like, oh, let me just pull up Little Sims. That's just kind of how I think as a DJ. So the smart crate option definitely helped me with that particular kind of thinking. My bad.
If you wanted to throw a grenade on your library, isn't there a way to move the Serato library to another location and then rebuild it?
Yeah. Yeah. Right. So, yeah, if you go to your, let's see here. So if I go to my music folder, and I go to my Serato underscore folder. No, I don't use iTunes, no. Yeah. I mean, a lot of people still do, and it still works, but for me, I'm... Yeah, so I found that for me, it was just a lot... more efficient for me to just build crates on my drive and then just literally make crates that kind of reference those folders that I created on the drive. So therefore, every time I add something new, like say in my hip-hop crate or if say my, you know, house classics crate, I'm like, oh, I got this new, you know, this Todd Terry record I just discovered and I throw it in there. I can literally drag that folder into the crate and it's literally just going to update it with just the songs that I added. So, yeah. And for me, I don't really listen to music that much on iTunes, so it was not that much of a deal breaker for me. In the back? No, not into the smart crate, but in a regular crate. Yeah, yeah. Yep. So yeah, so it's not going to create doubles of things that are in there. It's literally just going to drag in the new items that I updated the folder with. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, but yeah, so the files panel is definitely the way that you should probably do a lot of this organization. So you can see on the screen. Yeah, so if you're moving things around from drive to drive or from one folder to another, it definitely helps to do it in the files panel just because the program knows what you're doing. As opposed to doing it in the Finder. So like if you have like, you know, I don't know, a hip-hop folder on your drive, and then you drag something into a New York hip-hop folder on your drive, Serato won't know. It'll just know that the files should be there, the file path is now different, and it doesn't know where it is. So, but if you do it in the files panel, the program actually keeps up in real time.
Oh, so it'll change the file path?
That's right.
Because sometimes I'll change, like, I'll do the same thing, I'll, like, mirror my
crates. Yep. 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 Absolutely, yeah. Yep. So if you do any of that updating or name changing or moving in the Finder, Serato is not going to have any idea what's going on. But if you do it in Serato, then it keeps up. So you can, but you just have to keep track mentally of what's going on because Serato is not going to do it for you. Sorry, say that again. That's what we recommend, yeah. Yeah.
Just to add on to that, if you want to take any music from your internal drive and you do it in the files panel, you drag it to an external drive while you're in the files panel, it'll give you a pop-up menu and say, you want to copy, do you want to move, or do you want to cancel?
Right.
And if you copy, it's going to copy the whole thing to the other drive, and you can have them live, you know, in harmony.
Yep.
Or you can move it, and it'll update everything in Serato. It's the way to do it, for sure.
Yeah.
Yep. You're transferring a folder from your desktop in file. Are you saying that if it's updated on the desktop, it'll automatically update in the crate?
If you do it in the files panel. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. If you do it in the Finder, no. Nah. Yeah. Yeah. So we're going to wrap it up in a second, but Raj made a mention of beat grids earlier, and I just want to show you guys that real quick, just because it's another useful tool that might come in handy, especially if you play a variety of genres and unquantized live drummer music that's off a grid, like Mona Lisa does in the back. And yeah, let me just show you real quick. Damn, we've been using this GTA. We gotta update this shit. So anyway, so here's an example that we like to use. It's a very old transition track by GTA and Diplo. And basically, we use this one because it changes tempo a couple times, and the actual tempo in Serato can keep up with it. Because, you know, sometimes if you have a track that maybe starts on a weird count, or it's got some kind of weird rhythm in the beginning, maybe it's a broken beat track, or maybe it's some, like, swinging DiBiase or Dilla drums track, it might say the shit is 123 and it's really 94, you know? So the easiest fix for that is literally just go in and change the beat grid, and it really doesn't take as much time as you'd think at all. Like, for me, it took me a couple times to, like, kind of get the concept, because I wasn't getting it at first, but now it's like, oh man, it literally takes a couple seconds to fix the beat grid. So I'm just gonna show you real quick an example. So we know this is at 130. And we know it's at 130 because if we loop it, it's gonna be on. Right about here is when it drops. Tempo dropping. And then it stays at 110. So I'm just going to show you real quick how to quickly do that. So the first thing that you want to do is locked file. You want to hit your edit grid button. It's kind of small, but it's right above your sync. And if you hit that, it's going to open up the ability to actually change your beat grid. So I'm just going to clear all this. So now there's no grid at all. But we know this is the one. So I'm just going to click set up here. Another a keyboard shortcut is X. So you can hit either X or set. And now it's set. But as we saw, the beat is actually at 130 BPMs, and Serato thinks it's 110. So we're just gonna play it. So this is the one. This is where my second bar is. So you see that little two that appears right here? I'm just gonna adjust so that it comes back to where the two should fall. And now you see the three is on time, the four is on time, and so on. So we played this track, so we know that it keeps the same tempo till about this other cue point. And then this is where it starts to change. So I'm gonna just click set again. And then it changes a little bit, so I'm just gonna set a new one here. Just setting new markers. So basically they're like serving as anchors. So every time I set a new one, it's now locking to a new tempo. That's right. Absolutely. Yeah. Yep.
And that means that if you have, let's say that you have a loop playing on the track two,
yep.
Unused one.
Yep.
Would follow that tempo all the way down with it, right?
Exactly. So beat gridding is really important, not only for looping, but as Rod said, it's also really important for using sync and also for using slicer. So if you ever, you know, if you use an S9, you might notice that the slicer's on there. A lot of people look at it and they go, what the hell is that? They try it, it doesn't sound right, and they're like, fuck this. But it's because your beat grid's not, I'm sorry, your tracks aren't beat gridded on the one like how they should be. But if they are, then every hit will fall where it should on the slicer.
Is there any way to change like the default setting of the beat grid from basically 4 beats per bar to like 3? Because I have some like, there's like some weird deep house tracks, right? Where like they'll have like this weird buildup.
Sure.
And it'll be like 4 beats per bar, but right before the drop, it might only be 3 beats per bar.
Right.
Right.
No, I don't think that that's possible. But you can also you can all.
What you're not doing is just basically lying and saying there's 4 beats.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. Right. Yeah. I mean, the name of the game for me is just making sure that the tempo is accurate.
Right. Sure.
You know. But yeah, at the moment, no. Yeah. Absolutely. Yep. And we have tutorial content for all of these things on Serato.com and on our YouTube. So yeah. So if you guys have any questions about it, you can reach us, and you can also check out our YouTube too.
And if you get a track that doesn't have a beat grid, like Serato's real good. Like once you hit that first one, it'll analyze the rest of the track and usually be like right on the
Yeah, exactly. So the point was, if it's a track that's quantized and it's like, you know that the tempo doesn't change throughout, usually if you set it in that first, usually couple bars, then it's usually locked. Yeah, and then in the event that it does for some reason, maybe it's a Mad Villain track with a jazz interlude or some shit, which happens, then you can always just set it right on that next one that it comes in and you're locked. Yeah.
Question. Can you tell everybody, we're going to take some group photos of
Oh, okay, word. Yeah. Yeah, all good. Cool. So we're going to wrap it up in a second, but Raj wanted me to let you guys know that we're going to take a group photo, so if you can hang out and not just run out, that'd be dope. Yeah, any more questions? Yeah.
One last quick question for Raj. If someone's they don't have a BPM Supreme account, has tried to get one, and for whatever reason hasn't asked for a friend, how might they?
We're very friendly. You can always talk to myself and any of the team here, but I'll give you my info.
Yeah. Dope. Yeah, thank you all for coming. I appreciate all the questions. And yeah, thank you. Yeah, man. All this information is just, it becomes a lot. And it becomes obvious to us because we kind of deal with it all the time, but we recognize that everybody's at different levels. And we're just happy to have you guys using our products and interested in taking it to another level with what's possible. So that's what's up. It's good to see you outside.
Thank you.
Yeah.